The Lord knows that we don't want her to have to fill that gap. Amen? Amen. Amen. All right, let's go before the Lord. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for each and every individual here tonight, God. Lord, I simply give you all the praise and honor and glory, great God. Lord, I just help us to praise you, God. Help us to worship you, great God, in spirit and truth. In Jesus' great name I pray. And everybody said, amen. Give him a great big hand clap as you sit down.
Do you remember the day you got saved? Well, a couple people. Maybe we need to fill up the altars now. Do you remember when you got saved? I'll never forget it. Amen. Amen. Long years ago, when out in sin, I had no hope, no peace within. Down on my knees in agony, I prayed to Jesus and he gladly set me free. I never shall forget the day when all the burdens of my soul rolled away. It made me happy, glad, and free. I'll sing and shout it, for he's everything to me. Now I can feel him by my side. My feeble steps, he comes to guide. When trials come, he comforts me. Through faith in him or sin, I have the victory. Come on now. I never shall forget the day when all the burdens of my soul rolled away. It made me happy, glad, and free. I'll sing and shout it, for he's everything to me. Oh, sinner, come to Jesus now. At his dear feet, just humbly bow. Confess to him your every sin. He'll save and cleanse and give you peace and joy with him. Come on now. I never shall. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We're doing this just for Jessica tonight. Well, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Most High. Come on, let me hear you tonight. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Most High. Holy is the name of the Lord. Well, holy is the name of the Lord. Holy is the name of the Lord. Holy is the name of the Lord. Most High. Holy is the name of the Lord. Holy is the name of the Lord. Holy is the name of the Lord. Most High. See your tower tonight. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into.
strong tower. The righteous run into it, and they are saved. Oh, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, and they are saved. Oh, lift up the praise. Well, blessed be the name of the Lord. He's worthy. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. Oh, we sing, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High.
Now you act like you're starting to get into it tonight, starting to feel it a little bit. We're going to do this song one more time. Turn around, shake hands with just a couple of people right next to you. Get limbered up. Tell them, come on, let's shake the foundation tonight. Let's shake the house tonight, amen? Our God is an awesome God. He's worthy of all praise. He stands by our side no matter what we do. And the Bible says we are to lift up His name, enter His courts with thanksgiving, enter His courts with praise. We come tonight to worship Him and bless our God, amen? tonight. Come on. Again, oh, we lift it up to him tonight. How great is our God. Oh, sing with me. How great is our God. Oh, see how great is our God. See you. face and tell Him, oh, He is worthy. Jesus is worthy of all praise. Amen. Oh, in my heart, oh, my heart will see how great is our God. You know, the Bible tells us, give me just a minute, keep playing. The Bible tells us tonight that the devil decided, I'm going to ascend above God. I'm going to ascend, and I want that glory, and I want that praise, and I want them to worship me. Oh, but you know what? He doesn't get that worship tonight. Matter of fact, when you're sitting in your seat tonight, and you begin to lift those hands up and begin to praise the almighty name of God, he begins to get a little mad. The devil begins to run. Why? Because he can't receive it. You won't give it to him. He'll try to do everything he can, no matter what your affliction you're under, no matter what trial you're under. You can stand bold and stand strong and praise the name of Almighty God, because He is there on your side, working on your behalf. Amen. Oh, let's do that little part again. He's the name above all names. Tonight, if you don't feel Him, shake yourself.
He's the name above all names.
Let me hear you tonight.
Worthy of our praise.
Oh,
and my heart will sing how great is
our God. Now lift it up, how great is our God tonight.
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, we see how great
is. I'm going to have them just play it. Just begin to lift your hands and worship Him tonight. Give Him a love offering tonight. Come on. Don't be afraid to worship Him. He is worthy. Oh, tell Him you love Him tonight. Tell Him He's great and greatly to be praised. Your answer's coming. Your breakthrough's coming. There's nothing the devil can do to hinder it. God's already got it coming.
Oh, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great.
Oh, I feel Him tonight.
Is our God. Oh, see how great is our God.
Let's do that name above all names just one more time.
'Cause He's the name above all names. Worthy of our praise. And my heart will sing how great.
Now I want you to do it the best you've done it all night. How great is our God.
How great is our God. Oh, sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, we see how great. How great is our God. Oh, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, see how great is our God.
Hallelujah. Give Him the biggest hand clap of praise. Hallelujah.
Jessica, write it down. Steve did not miss a word tonight. Amen. Amen. Missed many words? Okay.
Yeah, he didn't miss one. He missed a lot.
It's good to be in God's house tonight, isn't it? Aren't you glad you can come out on a day that maybe wasn't too great of a day for you? And you can get into the presence of God with other believers? And all of a sudden, all those troubles and all those problems and all those worries just sort of go away. Go away. Because we serve a great and a mighty God. Amen? Amen. We don't serve a little nobody. We serve the one that spoke and it came into being. You know, there's an old cartoon that shows these scientists talking to God. And they look at God and they say, "We finally figured out how to make man out of dust." And God looks at him and says, "Okay, that's fine. Now go out and make the dust." You see, man thinks that he knows it all. But man's knowledge is foolishness compared to God. Because we serve a great and a mighty God. I said, no matter what our problem is, God has an answer for it. You know, you can go to the library and it's full of self-help books, right? Anymore, there's a self-help book on everything. You know, computers for dummies. You know, this for dummies, that for idiots, this for people who don't know anything, all that. But you know what? All they need is one book. Amen. The Bible. Amen. All they need to know is that, like the old Andre Crouch song said, Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there is no other, for Jesus is the way. Amen? Amen? That's what the world needs, is to know that Jesus is the way. And how is the world going to know that Jesus is the way if we don't show them Amen. That Jesus is the way? If we don't live it whenever we leave this place, if we don't live it out there, we can come in here and we can worship all we want in here, but if we don't live a life of worship outside of these four walls, what good is it doing us? We can come in here and we can pray and we can, you know, just be the best person in the world in here, but when we walk out of here, it's what the world sees out there that's going to make the difference. Because the world's not going to hear it in the news. The world's not going to hear it proclaimed from the White House. The world is only going to hear the good news of Jesus Christ through us. Amen. And if we aren't willing to take it out of here, what is it? Jesus said, "Behold, the fields are white and ready now for harvest. Pray the Lord of the harvest." Because there's not enough people out there. There's not enough workers out there. We are all called to do that, to take the gospel outside of here. Amen? We serve a great and a mighty God. I mean, my goodness, we tell people about our achievements, don't we? I mean, whenever our kids have an achievement, we have it announced up here, right? You know, I had Jenna announce, she had straight A's. My God did better than that. Shouldn't we be willing to announce to the world, I serve a living Savior? What's the old song? I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, matter whatever men may say. I mean, think about it. We need to tell the world about Jesus Christ. Amen? So what you feel in here, don't leave it in here. Take it out of here and let somebody else know about the Lord. Amen? Like I said, it's good to be in the house of the Lord. It's good to see a good crowd out on a Thursday night. It is Thursday, right? I'm losing track of my nights. A good crowd out on a Thursday night. Amen? Amen. I'm going to ask Keith to come on up. Cricket, are you guys about ready? So you guys get ready. Keith, come on up. I was looking forward to the car wash. My car was dirty, but if anybody wants to wash my car before Saturday, you know, you can do that. I just want to throw that out there. So.
On Sunday, on both services, actually, I talked about first fruit tithing. We talked about the importance of first fruit tithing, the difference between just tithing and first fruit tithing. And I even told you at that point that I felt like, due to the importance there, that if you all hadn't noticed any difference in it, it was probably only because you hadn't ever practiced first fruit tithing. I also said at the very end, I even challenged everybody. That's when Steve said that the preacher mode kind of kicked in up here. And I challenged you, if you haven't practiced first fruit tithing, maybe you ought to start. God would certainly bless you. Everything in the scripture indicates that God will bless you if you do that. But one of the things that I didn't do is, and tonight I'm going to finish that. This is the third and final thing on the first fruit tithing. I didn't talk in the scriptures as far as what he had promised us. So first off, I want to read you in Malachi. This is 3:10. It's very, very common scripture that you all heard. But it says, "Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house. And prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it." A lot of people have preached this before. It's a very common thing, but you know, it's the one place in the Bible where he says that. He does. He says it right out, flat out. Prove me. Test me. Try me. See if I'm not going to do what I said I would do. Now, when God tells you he's going to do something and he says, "Test me," do you really think there's any possibility he's going to let you down? Do you really think there's any chance he's going to let you down? Not a bit. Now, on top of that, that's about tithing. One of the things I also wanted to read was about first fruit tithing, was the other scripture I had. And this was in Proverbs 3, 9 and 10. And it's the same type of promise. It says, "Honor the Lord with thy substance," that's possessions, "and with the first fruits of all thine increase. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty, and thy presses shall burst out with new wine." God's telling us right there, if you do these things, if you honor me with first fruits, this is the kind of blessing you're going to do. If you do, I will do. Amen. Guess what? A lot of people say that they don't get the blessings from God. But you know what? He said, if you do, I will do. He didn't say, I will do regardless of what you do. And unfortunately, that's kind of the way we translate it a lot of times. We're going to do it our way, and then, God, you still go ahead and bless us? It's not exactly the way it reads here, folks. Sometimes it requires something of us first. It's time for us to take up our tithes and offerings and have the ushers come forward, please. I'm going to ask Rhonda if she would pray over the offering tonight, and you can beat me up later, Rhonda, if you catch me.
They asked me before service if they could do the song, and I told them no. And then I was like, okay. This will be the third time that they have done this song. And the other two times that they have done it, it has went off, if you have not been here, phenomenally. And I was sitting back there, and I was thinking, there's a part in the song that says, "No more shackles, no more no more bondage, I am free." But at the beginning of the song, it says, "Jesus said it." And I never really thought about the words to the song, and I've never really put the words together, if that makes any sense. You know, but like Dad was saying tonight, you know, Jesus said, "No more shackles, no more chains, no more bondage." So when they do that, they always shake their hands. So what I want you guys to do tonight, if you're up to it, really worship with him and really, you know, get into it. And I don't mean like, because if you do this, your shackle ain't going to go very far. But really, I mean, I don't have kids, but I know my dad's probably wondering, how many of you have ever had children and you just want to be like, you know, shut up, Dad. So I just want you guys to stand up, get a little loose tonight, it's okay. I promise. And worship with him. If you don't get in trouble, Jesus said it. Okay, because you were closing on the iron. I totally lied. Honestly, I lied to you guys. I got the songs mixed up. Totally just kidding.
Jesus said, Jesus said, Jesus said.
Okay, so you gotta help. Paul, I know. Paul was talking about how my dad didn't forget the words. It's okay, I made up for him tonight, and I merged two songs together. Amen. Paul kind of threw this on me at the last minute, and again, I said no, and then I was like, surprise. The adults, Robin, that includes you. Don't be trying to run and hide. Kathy and Robert. They just started working on a new song. They've had two practices, so they're a little nervous. What? Get over here. So I want everybody again to stand back up. Stand back up. I know. It happens. Are you crazy? I don't know if you've ever heard this song, but it's called I Call You Faithful. And if you've went to Newport, we sing this song every time almost, I feel like. But it says, I call you holy. I call you faithful. I call you healer. I call you savior. And I was telling the drama team last night, the adults, part of, you know, it says, holy you are and holy you'll be. So, you know, it says, you're holy right now. You're my healer right now. And it says, healer you'll be. And like I told Robert and them last night, you know, that means that regardless of what we do and, you know, regardless of what Satan tries to do, that God's still going to be holy. He's still going to be our Savior. He's still going to be our healer. So Robin, wherever she went and hid, and Kathy and Robert, it's okay. I'll stand in the middle and give you the directions because they're scared.
Oh,
I've had a song in my head all day because, you know, he is what we need. Amen. If we need a healer, he is our healer. You know, if we have a need, he is that supplier of that need. Amen. He is our righteousness. You know, he is all that to us. And, you know, the thing is we need to realize that he is all that to us. Realize who he is to us. Because many times we think that he doesn't care about what we go through or doesn't care about our needs. But realize this, he is everything to us that we need him to be. Amen? Amen. Amen. Children's church, quietly. Are you going to sing now? Okay. All right.
Now when the Lord let down the hedge on Job to try him, he took all of his children and everything Job owned. But old Job didn't sit down and cry. He just lifted his head up high, came out of that valley, and come with a whole lot more. I'm gonna walk right out this valley, lift my hands and praise the Lord. Said they ain't gonna let old Satan get me down, down, down. Why should I sit here till I die? Living the way just a little bit higher. And I'm gonna walk out this valley with my Lord. Now the road that you gotta travel to that city, it won't always be on the mountaintop. Oh, but the valley we gotta face, God said he's gonna give us grace from that mountain where the sun is shining bright. And I'm gonna walk right out this valley, lift my hands, praise the Lord. Said they ain't gonna let old Satan get me down, down, down. Why should I sit here till I die? Better to wait just a little bit higher. I'm gonna walk out this valley with my Lord. Well, I'm gonna walk right out this valley, lift my hands, and praise the Lord. Said they ain't gonna let old Satan get me down, down, down. Why should I sit here till I die? Better to wait just a little bit higher. I'm gonna walk out this valley with my Lord. Now when the Lord let down the hedge on Job to try him, he took all of his children, everything Job owned. But old Job didn't sit down and cry. He just lifted his head up higher, came out of that valley. Thank God with a whole lot more. But I'm gonna walk right out this valley, lift my hands and praise the Lord. Said they ain't gonna let old Satan get me down, down, down. Why should I sit here till I die? Heaven's away just a little bit higher. And I'm gonna walk out this valley with my Lord. Now the road that you gotta travel to that city, it won't always be on the mountaintop. But the valley we gotta face, God said he's gonna give us grace. Come on that mountain where the sun is shining bright. I'm gonna walk right out this valley, lift my hands and praise the Lord. Today I'm gonna let old Satan get me down, down, down. Why should I sit here till I die? Heaven will wait just a little bit higher. I'm gonna walk out this valley with my Lord, with my Lord, with my Lord, with my Lord. Amen.
I'm going to ask you a question. What kind of message are you expecting tonight?
The one I need.
Boring one? One that's going to challenge you a little bit, I hope. Now, if you don't want to stand for the reading of the word, I guess I understand because you've been yo-yoed tonight. So that's your call. But we're going to go to Ecclesiastes chapter 11. I love you. You're awesome. I am going to preach from some verses that I have never preached from before. And I'll be honest with you, I heard a preacher speaking on Ecclesiastes 11, but not these verses. Got into it, read it, studied it. I thought, all right, it's good. I like it. And I think the Lord's given me some stuff to go along with it. Amen. Now, I might get a little ornery. Just telling you. Okay. You'll have to forgive me. And if you don't, the gunman's at the door. Talk to him. That's all I got to say. Ecclesiastes 11. Having a hard time finding Ecclesiastes? There it is. All right. I'm going to go to verse 4, 5, 6, and 7. Ecclesiastes 11, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Verse 4 says, if you wait for perfect conditions, you will never get anything done. God's ways are as hard to discern as the pathways of the wind and as mysterious as a tiny baby being formed in a mother's womb. Be sure to stay busy and plant a variety of crops, for you never know which will grow. Perhaps they all will. Light is sweet. It's wonderful to see the sun. That sounds good, doesn't it? That's like poetic. Ooh. Get all warm and fuzzy when I read that. Let's pray. Father, I come before you tonight, God, thanking you for your blessings. Lord, I pray that you would anoint me tonight, great God. Anoint my mouth, God. Anoint my heart. Father, help me to bring forth the words, God, that I feel that you've put down in my heart. God, prepare the souls, God, of the people that are here tonight. Prepare their minds and prepare their hearts. God, bless them richly with your word tonight, we pray. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Give God a hand clap, if you would, please, for have a seat. Before I get into the message, I want to say that I was watching you from behind tonight, and I was noticing more hands being raised during the worship part of the service. And as your pastor, I commend you for that. And I commend you not just because it looks good when you got your hands raised, but when you can raise your hands often enough and praise God without being afraid. Man, you're on your way to winning the victory. That's all I got to say. Amen. Give God a hand clap for that. As I said, I heard a preacher preaching this week, and I listened to a lot of preachers. I told Lori, I said, I have found two new preachers that I like. I can't remember their names right now. They're not your standard Pentecostal preachers. I like the ones that just bring the fire down. Well, these guys, if you listen to them, you might think they're boring. Somebody say amen. We Pentecostal people, if there's not yelling and screaming and hollering and running and shouting, it's boring. But sometimes it's meaty. Sometimes you actually have to listen to what they're saying to get something out of it. And I got to say, you know, I was listening to this guy, and I was getting pretty pumped. In fact, it was one of those guys that you had to keep going back and replaying what they were saying so that you realize, did I get it right? Did I catch that? And I was floored by the knowledge that this fellow had. And I heard some comments that were made about this preacher, and it said he sounds like he's mad. Sometimes we Pentecostal preachers, when we preach, we sound like we're mad. This guy wasn't mad. This guy had something to say. And it was important enough that he demanded pretty much that the congregants listen to what he's saying. He got to a point in a sermon, and he mentioned something that we all know, but I had never heard it worded this way. He was talking about how great Paul was. He was talking about the mindset of Paul. He was talking about the way Paul thought. He said Paul was the kind of man that could not be rattled. He was the kind of man that no matter what was said or done, he had some cocky, arrogant, spiritual reply. Can you be spiritual and be cocky and arrogant? I think when you're dealing with your enemy, he thinks you are anyway. Somebody say amen. So to me, you know, Paul, no doubt, when he thought and said some of these things, it was amazing. So he gave some examples. He said, if Paul was threatened with death, Paul didn't scream and run like a little girl or a pansy little boy. Paul's response would be, for me to live as Christ, but to die is what? Gain. Now, how many of you, if your life was threatened because of what you believe in, how many of you would say to die is gain? Amen. Or how many of us, if our lives were threatened for what we believe in, how many of us would say, well, I don't believe in that anymore? Some of the people that followed Jesus, when their lives were threatened, they said, I don't believe that anymore. Paul was the kind of man that when his life was threatened, he weren't scared. Somebody say amen. He'd say, do your best. Bring it on. Because if you take my life here, I'm going home to the glory world. It doesn't really matter. Somebody say amen. He went on to say, if Paul was threatened with physical harm, he would say, it has been granted to us not only to believe, but also to suffer. Somebody say amen. You see, Paul believed that in his walk, it wasn't just for us to be blessed all the time. It wasn't just for us to walk on a road full of roses with no thorns in it. Paul realized that living in this life, there were some difficulties. Somebody say amen. I like this last one the best. If Paul was threatened with imprisonment. This is one of those sections that I had to keep going back because every time I heard it, I get more and more excited. When Paul was threatened with imprisonment, Paul would respond this way. Fine. Then I'll just convert all your jailers and most of your prisoners. Somebody say amen. So you see, there was this cocky arrogance about Paul, but it was the right kind of cocky arrogance. He was not afraid. We talked Sunday about the faith in God. Paul had a faith in God that would not waver. Paul had a faith in God that when he was scared, he didn't tell you that he was scared. If Paul was, threatened by an enemy, he didn't show the enemy that he was scared at all. He didn't even attempt to run. In fact, he'd stand there and say, fine, I'm going to call upon the God of all glories, and you can do whatever it is you want to do. Somebody say, man, I'm getting excited, I told you. Paul was not afraid. We can learn from Paul. Paul was a successful Christian. Paul was a successful man of God. And how did he do that? He was not afraid to do what God called him to do. A lot of us deal with that fear of doing what God has called us to do. And it doesn't actually only mean a ministry. It could just be talking to your husband or your wife or your neighbor or your friend or your cousin or your coworker. There's a fear in that. Because again, I think we spoke about this a couple weeks back. We're afraid to be ridiculed. We're afraid to be mocked or laughed at. But Paul didn't care. These scriptures then, Ecclesiastes 11. Permit me to go slow here. The writer of this is who? Some of you Bible scholars tell me. Solomon. Solomon didn't use his name when he referenced himself in these scriptures. And there's a reason why Solomon didn't give his name. He basically called himself the what? The preacher. And the reason he called himself the preacher was, and this is what a commentary that I read said, that he, up to this point, he had made some big boo-boos. He had made some big mistakes. He was afraid to announce who he was because you would equate his name with all the mistakes that he made. Solomon was one of those guys that he went after whatever he wanted to go after. In life, he would be equated to some monstrous CEO of some big company. Nothing stood in his way. If he wanted it, he got it. If he wanted a 1,000th wife, crazy man, he'd go get it. Somebody say amen. If he wanted another castle, he had the money, he'd build it. If there was a country that he wanted to take for his own, he would send his armies and he would take that country for his own. There was nothing that Solomon prevented himself from having. But Solomon realized that there was a catch to that. He said, if I go after all these things and I do my dead level best to make myself happy, there's an issue. And that's where we get that saying, Solomon summed it all up. Everything in this life is vanity. What is vanity? It's a waste of your time. Somebody say amen. It's nice to have the finer things of life, Norman, but you know what? In the end, it gets you nowhere. And can I say this? In the end, it doesn't impress him at all. Somebody say amen. And I keep going back to this. To him, he realizes it's only dirt. Somebody say amen. It doesn't mean anything to him. And Solomon would say it more and more and more and more. He says, guys, it's all vanity. Do what you want to do, but realize one day you're going to have to reckon for what you did. Somebody say amen. You know, when I read that scripture verse, I think of some of the preachers that are debating today. I want to drink. You know what Solomon say? Go ahead and drink. Some of them say, I want to do dope. He'd say, well, go ahead and do your dope. He'd say, I want to go out and party and carouse around with women. He'd say, go ahead and party and carouse around with your women. But you know what he'd say? But let me remind you of something. There is a day coming that you're going to have to stand in front of God and you're going to have to reckon for what you did. Somebody say amen. I've had people come to me and say, Pastor, I still drink. Can I come to church? I said, absolutely. Pastor, I still sin from time to time. Can I come to church? Absolutely. Why do you say that? Keep coming to church. You know why? Because it's almost impossible for you to continue to come to church and not be convicted at some point. Amen. Somebody say amen. I don't care what your lifestyle is. I don't care what you're doing. You can't continue to come to a true Bible-believing church and not feel the conviction of God. Somebody say amen. Now, of course, if you're going to one of those watered-down kind, that's your fault. Somebody say amen. But I'm going to tell you something. This is off the record just a little bit here. If you keep coming to the right church, it's going to upset you. Somebody say amen. Jewel, there is going to be a spiritual warfare when you walk in. And you know what the enemy's going to do? The enemy's going to make you think that it's the people there. Amen. Come on, I told you I'm going to get a little ornery here tonight. The enemy's going to tell you that it's the preacher. He doesn't like you. It's the music minister. He doesn't like you. It's the whatever in the church. They don't. You know what? That's baloney. That's garbage. Pitch it in the trash. It's a spiritual condition. Somebody say amen. There's something going on in here. You can blame it on whoever you want to blame it on, but you've got some growing to do in the Lord. Somebody say amen. Amen. You can tell anybody I said that because I really don't care at this point. Amen. Let me move forward. I'm getting mean. I said I was going to get ornery. This scripture verse starts off. My NLT is a little different than what was on the board. It's referring to a farmer. It says, a farmer who waits for perfect weather will never plant. Amen. If they watch every cloud, they will never harvest. Somebody say amen. Now, can I go slow? Here's what we Christians do, Brenda, and I'm proud of you, by the way. Here's what we do. We have been around church for a long time. Who in here has been around church a long time? Raise your hand. Come on. You have learned, and God give me wisdom here. You have learned how to read the church people. Come on, help me. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. I'm guilty of this. You can read the look on their face. Somebody say amen. They got the pouty look going on today. They got the mean look going on today. You get the glare. And the glare is, you know, I'm mad at you, and you better watch it, because if you don't, I'm going to let you have it. Am I telling the truth? We've learned how to read people, haven't we? And Norman, here's what we do, depending on who it is. Ooh. If it's the mean pastor's wife, everybody walks on eggshells. Somebody say amen. If it's the mean sister Katie over here, see, she didn't know I was going to get her, did she? There you go. She hangs out with Lori too much, so Lori's rubbing off on her. Somebody say amen. So we're reading the people, aren't we? And normally if we read the people, well, Lori and Sister Katie's in a bad mood. We better walk on eggshells tonight. I'll even give that one to you. If the pastor's in a bad mood, you better walk on eggshells tonight. Somebody say amen. And what does that mean, Paul Estep? If certain people in the church are in a bad mood, then we're not going to invest in the service. We're going to sit and we're going to watch everybody and see how they're going to react in the service. Ooh, I told you I was going to get ornery. We're not paying attention to what God is saying to our hearts. We're not listening to the word that's being brought to us from a man or a woman of God who have spent time in prayer, seeking God's face, asking God to tell them what to preach. You, God, you know who's going to be there. Tell me what to bring forward so that your people can be fed. So instead of listening to what God wants you to hear, we're focused on other things. What'd that scripture say? The farmer who does what? Who waits for the perfect weather will never plant. And if they watch every cloud, oh, I felt a mean streak coming on here. If they watch every cloud, they will never harvest. Does anybody know where I'm going with this? If we watch every pouty, sad face, whiny butt that walks into the house of God, if we keep our minds focused on them, we will never, ever, ever get anything out of what God has for us in His house. If we continue to focus on negative, 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 you will never plant anything and you will never harvest. So, Pastor, what's planting? Are we planting seeds so we can get an apple tree? Let's talk at this from a spiritual sense. Let's plant some praise and worship, even though I don't feel like it. You work umpteen hours a day out in the hot, right? You have every reason and under the sun not to come in here and worship God. In fact, most of us would totally understand you going home and going to bed. If he said that to me, I was like, Norm, go, buddy, I understand. Go and go to bed. He did that, and he got in the habit of doing that, there is no planting. There is no faith. There is no growth there. Somebody say amen. I'm going to tell you something. Sometimes the enemy will come at you so hard. This is the hardest thing in the world to do. Somebody say amen. Let me go a little bit further. The enemy will come at you so hard going, praise God, is the hardest thing to do. Somebody say amen. The enemy will come at you so hard, you know what? Your memory goes. Not because you're senior aged, but because the enemy has taken away all of your memory about all the great things that God has already done for you. So we sit there or we go home and watch the stupid box and we do nothing. We don't plant anything. We don't do anything. So can I tell you something? If you don't plant anything, if you don't do anything, if you don't move forward, there is no harvest. There is none. Pastor, I don't feel the Lord anymore. You might want to check yourself. Pastor, God's not talking to me anymore. You might want to check yourself. Let me ask you this. Pastor, God's not talking to me anymore. Are you talking to Him? Somebody say amen. And here's a problem sometimes with our talk with God, Norman. It's always ask, 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 ask. And then when He asks something in return from you, hey, what about you doing this for me? Hey, what? He corrects you a little bit and says, you're not worshiping me enough. I know what you want. The God of all glory already knows what you want. He knows what you have need of before you know what you have need of. Somebody say amen. So we're asking Him for things. He already knows what you're going to ask for it. And guess what I know about my God? He's already telling you what you need to do to get it. Oh, I told you. He's already telling you, Norman. How many of you all had that little small voice get on to you? Somebody say amen. Here comes a sinner down the road. You need to talk to them. Somebody say amen. You know that person that's not been in church for a while? Pick up the phone and give them a call and find out where they've been. Somebody say amen. You know that brother or sister that's really struggling in the Lord? You need to give them a call or you need to go and visit them. But Lord, nothing planted, nothing harvested. Somebody say amen. Imagine you do what God says. Oh, let's all do what God says all week long. Somebody say amen. And then when you come into the house of God on Thursday, guess what? There's no guilt keeping your arm to your side. There is no little voice in your head saying you didn't do what I told you to do. Somebody say amen. You walk in knowing that you did what God told you to do. And when you know that God, when you did it, you know what? It's easy to do that. We're all Pentecostal people, Norman. We're all seeking for that ooh feeling. We want to be like David, Mom. We want to dance and whirl and twirl, don't we? We all want to do it. I want to do it. Somebody say amen. You know what? We don't do it. You know why we don't do it? We're worried. We're concerned. Somebody say amen. If I dance, I'm going to get made fun of. Oh, God, thank you. Let's look at it from Paul's perspective. Let's jump into the New Testament. If I dance, I most likely will get the victory. Somebody say amen. Let's look at it differently. Wayne is dancing in the Lord, planting a seed. Oh, saints of God, come on. You ever watch some of these people around here dance? That's plain funny. Somebody say amen. But you know what? It doesn't matter what you look like. If you're dancing because God said to dance, saints of God, you're planting something. And if I know my God, when you get lost in that dance, when you get lost in that praise, there is a blessing that is poured out upon you that you simply cannot contain. Give God a big hand clap, please. I could preach on this all night. If you don't invest, you can't expect anything to come back to you. If you don't put in, you're not going to get out. If you never seek the Holy Ghost, you're never going to get it. If you're, let me move forward. Number two, so little, reap little. sow much, reap much. I'm not going to make this about money, but this is an explanation that I heard one time. Many of us have been throwing in a dollar in the offering plate for the last 50 years. I tell them, I'm not making it about money. I'm just using it as an illustration. Those of you that are smart, what happens to that dollar over 50 years? Well, here, let's do this. Let's make it simple. Who in here 50 years ago, what could you buy with a dollar? Let me ask you this. Can you buy anything with a dollar today? So what happens to that dollar over time? It decreases in value. Somebody say amen. Sitting on your butt all the time in the church service, you've been doing it for 50 years, decreases in value. If you're doing nothing, Paul, you hit it, I don't know if you realize it, but if you're doing nothing, you don't have new people sitting around you. Somebody say amen. If you do nothing, there are no new people around you or in your life for you to help. Somebody say amen. Well, brother, I got somebody saved 50 years ago. They're grandparents by now. Somebody say amen. And if they're the proper kind of grandparents, they have produced. Somebody say amen. But you, in your spiritual self, have you produced? Have you sought out that person that you got saved 50 years ago to find out where their children and their grandchildren are? Somebody say amen. Now, saints of God, listen to me. And I believe this is where God wants me to go with this. We all have an ability to reap a lot in God's harvest. Somebody say amen. But it requires us to sow some into it. Somebody say amen. And Norman, buddy, if you want a lot, you had better reap a lot. If you better sow a lot. Did I say that right? We were out yesterday trying to teach Crystal how to witness to everyday, ordinary people, not churchy people. We went to your park across the road there, Brother Raj, and we passed out bubble gum. How many of y'all think that's a silly way to witness to somebody? We were passing out bubble gum. Bubble gum does what? Kids see it, buddy, and they're like, I know I'm not supposed to take it from strangers, but, and they run to it, right? That's what they do. We fortunately go straight to the parents and say, hey, this is what we're doing. Here's a flyer. Next thing I know, here comes the kids. Oh. Call Wayne, sir. He likes it when you call him sir. Amen. He had about 100 kids yesterday. Came, sir, can I have some gum? Thank you, sir. It's like, Dad, I'm not a sir. I'm like, to them you are. So we're sitting there, we're just chewing gum. All of a sudden, I start to blow a bubble. Messed up bad. Had blue gum all over my face. Telling the kids, man, they're blowing bubbles. They're trying to blow bubbles. I think we got warped gum or something. I don't know. Tightwad Norman bought the cheap stuff. But anyway. And then we walked up to this lady, the mom of one of the children. She didn't know me. I could tell she's probably as mean as Lana back there, you know, when I saw her. But I looked at her. I said, can you blow a bubble? Rhonda, she looked at me and she went, without getting blue gum on my lips? I said, sissy, whatever it takes. What do? We planted some. It was on our time. There were people there that were from China, Japan. There were people there from other areas of the country living in that area. What were we doing? We were planting something. Here's the cool thing. We're going to go back. And if we keep going back, you know what we're going to see eventually? We're going to see some babies sitting on pews in here. We're going to see some people that don't look like me and you sitting on the pews in here. Somebody say amen. And when we start to see them sitting on the pews in here and they hear the same messages that you hear and feel the same convicting power that you feel, guess what we're going to see one day? We're going to see an altar that's filled up with brand new babies in the Lord. What are we reaping? We're reaping a harvest. And then, Brother Dustin, we get them in here, we get them saved, we get them working, we get them growing in the Lord, and guess what we'll do? Eventually, we'll turn out some Holy Ghost, Spirit-filled people that'll find another park and go blow bubbles with strangers. Saints of God, listen to me. If you don't do anything, don't expect anything. Well, brother, I go to church and I teach that Sunday school class every week. Let me ask you something. How are you teaching? Are you teaching like it's the worst Bible study in the world? I've seen people do that, man. It's the worst stuff in the world to read, man. Norman, buddy, if I read it straight through, man, it's boring. Somebody say amen. For Brother Roger, if the Spirit of God gets in a good teacher, oh, man. Somebody's actually excited about what they're reading in the Word of God. Oh, wow. Those people that have never heard the Word of God before, they're going to watch you, and they're going to see an excitement in your face, and they're going to hear an excitement in your voice. They're going to say, I want that. They don't even know what it is. Somebody say amen. They don't even know what it is. We know what it is. The Spirit of God, when it is put out there, it will not come back void. Is that what the Bible says? It won't. That's one seed that you can just throw it out there, man, and it's going to hit somewhere, and somebody's going to take a bite. Somebody say amen. So what are you saying, Pastor? Everywhere you go, preach the gospel. Do I have to preach it like you? No. Sometimes all you got to do is blow bubbles. Somebody say amen. I know what you're thinking, Wayne. This is plain insane stuff. Jesus converted a woman by asking her for a drink of water. It's not difficult. If you've got the true God that we all know about, if you've got just a little bit of that Spirit bubbling in you, when you come in contact with a sinner person or a Christian who's struggling and riding the fence, when you talk to them with the Spirit of God pumping in love, they're going to feel something, saints of God. They're going to know that there's something real in you. Amen. Somebody say amen. Number three, making moves based on what you see will prevent you from sowing great seed. I know it's good, man. God gave it to me. Making moves based on what you see will prevent you from sowing great seed. You know what I hear a lot of ministers do? Talk about the past. 15 years ago, man, I preached a revival. The altars were filled. People getting healed. Deal with the Holy Ghost. People eat. Man, this is 15 years ago. What you done since? Not a whole lot. Somebody say amen. Not a whole lot. Man, there's this one time down in Newport I remember, man. I don't know if you remember this, Norman. We had this Sunday school class full of teenagers. The adults were dismissing from church. They were all done. Preacher was dry. My father, he was off his game that night. They were walking out, and you know what they heard? Shouting coming from the teen classroom. What have you done since? Well, I ain't done anything. That was the pinnacle of my ministry. That was the best I've got. You know what we got? Too many ministers talking about the old days. Too many people talking about how it used to be. Too many people talk about what used to be done in the house of God back then. Talking about the old days when they walked the streets and preached the gospel. They'd walk up into the bars and drag people out and pray them through right there in the street. They don't do that anymore. Let me ask you something. Why ain't you doing that anymore? Can I say this? If it worked then, it'll work now. The Bible says the God of yesterday is the God of today. And if he's the God of today, he's the God of tomorrow. So what is that saying? That's saying he's not changed. He's not wavered one way or the other, Norman. He's still there. You know what he's looking for? He's looking for a fired up, faithful child of God who is willing to listen and do what God is telling him to do. Somebody say amen. And here's the kicker, Christians. You don't base what you do, and you don't base your faith on what you see. There, I'll be honest with you. Can I be very open and honest with you tonight? I have purposefully ignored God when he's told me to do things. Shame on you. You know how I can say that? Because I know we've all done it. I know we've all done it. God will say, "Wayne, God, you know, if I do that, it's going to make people in the church mad." Am I telling the truth? God, now you know if I do that, it's going to make them mad. They're going to leave, man. Ties are already down. If they're already down, guess what? We don't need them to go any lower. Especially when you got Keith as a clerk, man. He's, Wayne's going down. Got to do something. Crucify me. I've done it. And I'll tell you the truth. I've talked to I don't know how many pastors who have done the same thing. Somebody say amen. And you know why we do it, Lori? We're looking at things. We're watching people. We're not planting because we're too worried about the weather. Somebody say amen. We're not being obedient to God because we're watching the numbers a little too much. Come on, man. There's a lot of preachers do that today, and I'm not knocking because I am one. Somebody say amen. But what happens if we start allowing those people, those clouds, we start letting those clouds block our vision of what's on the other side. You hear me? If we let those clouds block our vision of what's on the other side, we'll never get to see what's on the other side. I heard T.D. Jakes preach this one, another preacher. He said, you know, he works with new pastors now, and new pastors, they all have the same complaints, I guess, when they come to him. I'm learning some of those complaints. I get it. Some of these newbies come in, I'm like, dude, I'm sorry, man. It's good. It's going to happen to you a million times. Get used to it. He said, people would come running to him and say, Pastor, you know if you do that, you're going to upset this person. You know if you do that, Pastor, this church is going to get mad and leave. You know, Pastor, if you do this, they're going to stop giving. He said they'd run to his wife. He said his wife wouldn't say anything. She'd just give him the look. Here's what he said. He said, you know what? He said, I always try to put the words in her mouth for her. She didn't want to say nothing. You know why? Because in her mind, she had already had it made up. They weren't meant to be with me anyway. They weren't meant to be a part of my harvest anyway. How many of you know that the enemy sometimes will send people in to prevent your harvest? The enemy will sometimes send people in, and guess what they'll do? They'll do nothing but cause problems the whole stinking time. Somebody say amen. And you know what you got to do? You got to get to the place to where you realize they didn't call you. Somebody say amen. They didn't call you. They didn't tell you to do what God told you to do. They aren't the ones rewarding you when you do what God tells you to do. Somebody say amen.
They're not the ones that are standing there patting you on the back when you've obeyed God and you can see the harvest start to come in. They're not the ones that did it. Amen. Somebody say amen. You see, we get too busy watching the clouds. And the clouds prevent us from seeing what's on the other side. You know what we need to do? We need to do what Scripture says. Shake off those weights. Somebody say amen. Shake off those sins and those things that just so easily beset you. Shake off the things that make your mind heavy with worry. Somebody say amen. Shake off them people that do nothing but drag you down. How many's mad at me now? I know what the enemy's doing. He's making you think that I'm preaching about people you know. Somebody say amen. Now what he's doing, I know what the enemy does. Some of us sit there and go, oh boy, he's talking about that one. Oh, shut up, boy, I know, see? I know how you think. You know how I think that? Because I used to sit here too and go, oh man, he's getting Julie, woo. I bet you Lori don't act the same after this one. Yee-hoo. Am I telling the truth? There is a common thing that we pastors deal with, and it's people. People can be a ray of sunshine, or they could be the biggest cloud you've ever seen. Somebody say amen. You know what, saints of God? That don't just go for preachers. That goes for you too. The people that sit on the pews. Because you know, we all have the tendency to do this. We'll get our eyes off of God. And the person that's creating the biggest fuss, that's the one that gets our attention. They did not save you. They are not the ones that touch your sick body when you're laying in your bed racked with pain. Somebody say amen. They're not the ones that can miraculously out of nowhere give you what you need just when you need it. Somebody say amen. You know, I think I like this message because it nailed me to a wall. Somebody say amen. I'm feeling God, Norman. And I'm about to get all happy up in here. You know why? Because I learned something from this. Somebody say amen. You want to reap big, you better sow big. Somebody say amen. If you want to reap things that you've never reaped before, Norman, you got to get beyond all the naysayers and all the whiners and all the complainers and do what God has told you to do regardless of the repercussions. Somebody say amen. I want the Holy Ghost. Man, if I want the Holy Ghost, guess what you need to do? You need to start praising God with every ounce of breath that you've got in you, and you don't stop until you receive it. Well, that's too hard, Pastor. Then you're a wimp, and you're never going to get it. And let me get extra mean. No, I'm not. Some of you new ones that are thinking that I'm being too mean, I'm not. There are these things starting to come into my hair. Somebody know what they are? They're gray. Somebody was making fun of me the other day. And it was your daughter too, Miss Lana. You know, I said, I like it. I ain't covering it up. I'm not. Bingo. Kind of like the guy that I'm reading from the book that he wrote. He earned them. Amen. He earned them. My only prayer is that they turn silver. Amen. I think silver's cool, man. Tell y'all a story real quick before I move forward. My mom's gone. Remember back in the day when coloring your hair was a sin?
Somebody remember that? How many sinners we got in here tonight, right? Okay, I was just checking. All right, just checking. All right, y'all backslid according to them. I just want y'all to know that. Okay. My grandmother, God love her. She was a trip. Coloring her hair was a sin, boy. Ooh, she hammered it. Poor thing, she weren't very smart. That's all I gotta say. Does anybody remember Miss Claire All Shampoo? Somebody tell me what it is. It's dye. You know what? We could not convince my grandmother that it was dye. To her, it was shampoo. So when she used it, she wasn't sinning. Somebody say amen. The rest of you were sinning and going to hell, but not her, because she was just shampooing her hair. Somebody say amen. She's probably looking over the portals of glory, waving a finger at me right now. That's all right. John 34:4. Paul, you used this earlier. You didn't notice my glare. My food, said Jesus, is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Don't you have a saying? It's still 4 months until harvest. I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Even now, the one who reaps draws a wage and harvests the crop for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may be glad together. Thus the saying, one sows and another reaps, is true. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Did you catch that? Amen. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the hard work, and you have reaped the benefits of their labor. Does that make sense? No? Let me explain. He's telling us, and this is what we all do, we all reason with God, don't we? We all kind of bargain with him. God, you give me a little more training, a little more time in the service of you, and I'll go out and do it. Right? And what we do? Well, God, if you give me 4 months more of training, kind of like what I read in Scripture there, then I'll be ready. You know what he's saying to you now, Brother Russell? Time out. I don't want you to wait 4 months. I don't want you to think that you have to have more training. He's saying it's ready now. Amen. He's saying there's crop around you now. He's saying there are things that are just waiting for you to pick. Somebody say amen. Now. The harvest is ready now. That's what he's saying. And then he goes on to that second part. You don't understand. It said, you know what? You're about to reap something that you didn't work for. Oh, what does that mean? Donna, you've not been saved long, right? I get it. But you know what? There have been people saved a long time before you, and they've been out there working the fields already. Somebody say amen. And if you're obedient to God and do what God says, guess what? You might be able to go out there and pick one up because somebody planted the seed a whole long time ago. Amen. Now, Pastor, does that only go with witnessing to people? No. Please understand me. One thing about God's word is, man, it covers everything. If I praise when I don't want to praise, man, there's a harvest coming. If I give when I don't think I have enough money to give, there's a harvest coming. Somebody say amen. If I witness when I don't think I have the words, there is a harvest coming. Somebody say amen. If I learn to look beyond those stormy clouds, there's a sun waiting on the other side. Somebody say amen. What was that last verse there in 7? I'm slow. For then the dust will return to the earth. I'm looking at the wrong one. See, I come in the wrong spot.
Light is sweet. You got it? Light is sweet. It's wonderful to see the sun. Is that just a fluke verse? No. Sissy, it was in there for a reason. It's on purpose. So. Don't look at the storms. Don't try to figure out the wind. Somebody say, man, let me ask you this. Tell you this. Don't try to figure people out either. And let me do this. Don't even try to figure God out. God, why are you calling me? He's insane. Somebody say, amen. God, why are you telling me to do that? We can think it all we want to. He's insane. No. His thinking's not our thinking. His knowledge is not our knowledge. Somebody say amen. He does what he wants to do, and you can't figure it out. Let me have you stand, please. Here's the hard part of this message. Let me ask you something. Was it good? Who got hit? Did I get too ornery? No. Here comes the really hard part. How many of you are shutting down right now because you know what's coming? See, I know that happens too. Because you know what happens? Because we know what's going to happen here, right? So we immediately start bracing ourselves. I don't care what he says, I'm not moving. I don't care how hard my heart is beating in my chest, I'm not paying attention to it. Look at that. Somebody dealing with cancer. That makes you look bad. Oh my goodness, that makes you look bad. Pastor, you're being mean. Saints of God, I'm not being mean. Listen to me. Get beyond yourself. Get beyond your fears. Get beyond people. Get beyond worries. Get beyond whatever stupid reason the enemy's given you. Get beyond it. Plant, 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 plant. Pastor, I don't feel anything. Plant it anyway. Pastor, I don't feel a need to raise my hands. Raise it anyway. Pastor, I don't want to kneel down in the altar. Do it anyway. Pastor, the Lord's telling me to get somebody. I don't want to. Do it anyway. Father, I pray right now that you would move in this congregation. Father, I believe in my heart right now, God, that there is great opportunity for your people here tonight, Lord. God, there is a spirit here, God, that'll set them free from every bondage that they deal with. God, there's a spirit here, God, that'll change their negative minds and their negative thinking. God, there's a spirit here, God, that'll fill somebody up with the Holy Ghost. If they seek after it. God, there is a spirit here tonight. God, it's a spirit of freedom. God, it's a spirit of joy. God, it's a spirit of love. God, it's a spirit of happiness. God, it's here and it's real. God, it's here and it's real. You know what? Come on. Come on.
trusting, fully trusting in my Savior's love, doing what I can for heaven's holy dove. I'm getting ready to leave this world, getting ready to leave this world, getting ready for the gates of pearl, keeping my road bright, watching both day and night. Ready for
they want to. May have left already, but that's okay. I want to remind you, tomorrow night's the junior youth rally, is that correct? Bring your kids. 5 to 12. Bring them. They'll have some fun. Bring them. If you want to act like a 5 to 12-year-old, don't come. Just bring your 5 to 12-year-old. Amen. You want to act like a 5 to 12-year-old? You already do. That's cool. But we won't end the service officially because we still have people in the altars. But if you have to go, feel free to do so. Go ahead. Absolutely. Go ahead. You've got a hand clap for that, man. Amen. You know what? Realistically, those are the kind of testimonies we should be hearing all the time. Pastor Wayne, we were over here and we prayed somebody through. Pastor Wayne, we were over here and somebody got convicted. We prayed them through. My nephew this, my grandchild this, my daughter this, my neighbor this. That's the way it should be. And if we continue to show the Lord and not be afraid to show the Lord to people, revealing what he's done for us, letting them feel what we've got bubbling down inside of us, not letting the weights of this world prevent us from doing it. Man, we could be like Paul. We got the same attitude Paul had, right? Throw me in jail, I don't care. Kill me, I don't care. Beat me, I don't care. There's blessings in it, Norm. Announcement I forgot to make. Next Thursday, we have a guest preacher, pastor coming in. His name's Chris Combs. He pastors the Epicenter Church of God that used to be in Sparta. The problem is they've come up on some financial issues, and they really don't have a place to worship. They're worshiping in their house down in Sparta. We used to do that. We've been there and done that. He asked if he could bring his drama team to our church and have them minister to us and us take up an offering to help them. I said, absolutely. I said, we'd be hypocrites if we didn't help him. He's a good guy. I've known him. He used to be in my youth group, too, many years ago. Wow. But They're going to be here next Thursday. And I want you to really be praying, okay? God, what do you want me to give them? Because the offering that night will go to them. And I'm even considering giving them concession stand sales for that night. Because we were in a place where we were in a basement and we needed help to get out. Yep. So we need to help them as much as we can. And I want you to pray between now and then, maybe push back a plate. And if the Lord says for you to give them $50, give them $50. Did I preach tonight's message on purpose? No. But if you're planning into a ministry that I know this kid, man, you planted that ministry down in Sparta, it may not be us that reap the rewards, but somebody will reap it. And one day when you get into the glory world, they're going to say, you gave this, and because you did that, they could buy a church or lease a church, and because they could lease a church, I got saved. Amen. That's what it's all about. Let's all stand, please. If you can, stick around. Let's pray for Brother Dustin. I know he's seeking after the Holy Ghost, and let's encourage him. Get on the phone this weekend, saints of God. Get people. Bring them in. Sunday school is at what time Sunday? Is Sunday school important?
Yes.
Thank you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you now, God, thanking you for your blessings, thanking you for your spirit, thanking you for what you taught us, great God. Father, go with us. Help us to be great lights of this world, God. Give us a boldness, great God, to speak your word. Father, we give you praise for all things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you're going to stick around here, have respect for those on the altars. Amen.
Black as could be, Jesus came forth.